and welcome to It Matters Radio. This is Monica Brinkman. And joining me, of course, is Kenneth Ween. Hi, Ken. And we have with us today someone that we haven't talked to in many years, and we're so pleased that she could come join us today. And this is Karen Kondazian. And you might have known Karen as an actor. Also, she's a journalist, a producer, and an author. So she loves history. I know this. Ken, you were telling me about that also. And we just find history fascinating. So
Karen wrote a book, which we talked about the last time she was on the show. It's called The Whip. And it is a wonderful read, or listen, because there's a great audio version of it, too.
The girl who starred in Deadwood, Robin, yeah. Reading.
Yeah, Robin does a great job.
She loved doing that, you could tell.
But, and I don't want to talk too much about this book, except to tell you folks, it is about a young woman who decides that she does not want to be constricted by the roles of being a woman. And this, of course, is a long time ago. This is an historical novel. It's set in the 1800s in the Wild West. And this woman dresses as a man, cross-dresses, and becomes a stagecoach driver. And it's based on a real person.
Yeah.
And it is a fabulous read. It's called The Whip, W-H-I-P, as in, yeah, get along there. okay, and we're going to have a promo trailer of it at the end of the show. But, you know, the reason that I asked Karen to join us today is something a little different, which is we're friends on Facebook. I also follow her on Instagram. And Karen posts what I think are some of the most fascinating posts that I ever see in the social media. Now, some of them are out of her career, and occasionally she'll post, like, as an actress and theater personality, and she'll post a picture of her with somebody, or maybe just of the person, and reminisce about what she did together with that person or something. And those are fascinating to me. I'm a theater buff.
Yes.
A very small number of them are about her personal political views, but the vast majority, and this is the thing, is they're about history. Not just any history. She has taken on, I think single-handedly, a celebration of women in history.
Yes.
And she posts things like, who was the first female in the United States cabinet? Or who was the woman who flew across the Atlantic? All these things. Sometimes I even know the answers without having to look down. Not often, some. Sometimes I even get to add some information to her, for her, but most of the time it's just a pure learning experience. So the first thing I'm going to tell you folks, okay, and I was telling Monica this before, is if you are on Instagram and or Facebook, find Karen Kondazian and click follow.
It starts with my name, it's K, with a K rather than a C.
Yes.
Let's say it with a C.
Yes, both first and last name begin with a K.
Yeah.
Which I love.
And, and please follow her, because you'll learn. I mean, and hey, we might even get to interact, because as I say, I respond. I respond sometimes. So, Karen, how did you get interested? Did you drive your interest in women in history starting with The Whip? Or did you have the interest in women in history first, and that's what got you to find out about your main character in The Whip?
I've always, well, I'm a big reader. I was since a child, starting with the like Heidi
and working. Oh, yes.
No, I've always been interested in history. And then particularly, you know, we've always, I'm talking about in the 50s, 60s, 70s, it's always been about men. Mm-hmm. What man has done, whatever, because obviously there have been more men who have contributed, I thought, to the world than women. But all of a sudden, you know, I was very fortunate. I was doing a lot of television. You know, I was guest starring in this and that. And then when you reach a certain age as a woman, not as a man, on television, if you're not a gigantic star, you know, I did do a series, but it doesn't matter. You have to become a star. And then if you're not, you know, you don't work so much anymore. And that's what happened. I started doing a lot of theater, though, after that. But suddenly, you know, because of my love of reading, and I think I remember one of my first, Claire, what was, she was the nurse in the 1800s. Claire, Claire Booth? I forgot. But just right now it's gone. It'll come to me later. But she was a nurse during the war in the 1800s. And I remember reading that as about a 10-year-old. And I thought, you know,
Nightingale,
her name, I've forgotten. There were a couple of nurses.
Yeah, a couple. Yeah.
Nurses who had the guts, imagine, with all these men, you know, to take care of them, to be a nurse, helping, you know, and they didn't have very many people. They'd have very few doctors. That's why everybody, all these men were dying. Because they had no care. Anyway, to the question. So I wasn't working so much, and I had read about this interesting woman, Charlotte Parkhurst, and how she disguised herself as a man. Nobody apparently knew. She became a famous stagecoach driver. She drove so many famous people from here to there, particularly in California, up the coast of California. And, you know, I wanted to write about her because I thought that's a really interesting human being. Now, it's based, it says on the cover, it's inspired by a true story.
Yes.
Because we don't know. I went down to Watsonville where she lived. And, you know, there are all these people who have these stories. Who knows what story is true and what isn't?
Yes.
So, I got all the facts I could, sat down and wrote the book. And it took me like 8 drafts to do it. Strangely enough, by chance, a friend of mine who lives in Romania hadn't contacted me in a long time. He asked me to do a favor of a publisher that he knew in America who wanted to use some of his photographs. I contacted the publisher. He said, "Oh, what do you do?" And I said, "I'm a writer." I told him about the book. Mm-hmm. He said, "Look at it." So I sent him the book. Can you believe that my first book, like after 3 weeks of it having its first publication, I had a publisher.
And so I can't believe it because I've read it and it was worth it.
That's the long story of the whip. And so now I'm fascinated with a couple of other women that I'm looking at, maybe I will, you know, write about. So that's the story. That's how I got into it. So for all of you at work actors, you know, maybe, you know, look into writing.
The women that fascinate you.
Yeah. You know, we contributed just as much as men in this. I realized that. I went, look at all of these women who have done all these amazing things.
But we never hear about them. A few you'll hear about.
But Karen, do you have a pick? Tell us a couple that you're thinking you might want to write about. Who are a couple that stick in your mind right now? And we're not going to hold you to it.
Well, you know, right now there's a woman who really, I was just looking at her several times. Her name was Victoria Woodhull. Now, she was the title of this interesting article that I read about her, is The Prostitute Who Ran for President.
Mm-hmm. Ah, okay.
And so this is, of course, in the 1800s. And it's, she says, this is interesting. She says, I'm a free lover. I have inalienable constitutional and natural rights to love whom I may, to love as long or as short a period as I can, to change that love every day if I please, and with the right, neither you or any law you can frame have any right to interfere. And
he is a value system.
Anyway, she ended up marrying Cornelius Vanderbilt mm-hmm. in 1868,
wow.
who was like the apparently, supposedly, the wealthiest man in the world.
Yes, at the Vanderbilt, point. Yes.
She married him. And so, yeah, she didn't do so bad for herself.
But for a woman to say that type of thing at that time.
That's oh, right. Yes. It's exactly
I mean,
right.
It was unheard of.
Listen, I grew up, yes, in the 60s, mm-hmm. Sex, drugs, and rock and roll. But,
yes.
You know, my family, you know, I say my opinion, and I was told to be quiet. And I was mm-hmm. 14, 15 years old. You know, sit down and be quiet. Don't talk so much. My had a few of those.
Well, I can remember when they would, you know, when you're in high school, they would have all these companies come in. To, you know, in case they wanted to hire you and you can talk with them, these job fairs. And no one would talk to me in journalism, entertainment, anything that interested me. No, they out and out told you that, you know, go be a secretary.
Yes, secretary, nurse.
Go be a nurse.
Or
what? Yeah.
And you know, when Charlie Parkhurst, the character that I wrote about, you had three choices, which was wife, prostitute, or if you could read, and which very few women did, you could teach, be a teacher. That was it. There was nothing else.
Right.
And most of them ended up being mothers, you know, with their husbands leaving them to go to the gold rush. So having to take care of their own children all by themselves and the land, you know, having to, if they had a little bit of land and acreage of maybe grapes or whatever they had, you know, to have to take care of the land, they were, you know, they had a double job of the children and the land, and the husband was in California trying to find gold and sometimes never came back.
Oh, you know, that's interesting because a couple months back, we had another author on, and a very good friend of ours, Steve Lindau, who his latest book is called Living in a Star's Light, and it's based on a novel based on Lotta Crabtree, the actress and dancer.
She was a singer too, and dancer, right?
Yes.
She toured the Old West,
yeah.
And yeah, go ahead, I'm sorry.
The same thing about, you know, and in her case, well, the thing that made it so unique was that her father was a wastrel, but her mother was a great businesswoman. And,
that's funny.
And the women ended up being the power.
Yes, but that was very rare.
Very.
You know, in the old West. It was always the man. I mean, poor women, they died like flies, as you say, because of, you know, having, and childbirth, you
yeah.
know?
Yes.
You can't delivered your own child, you know, cut
yeah.
your own cord. If you were lucky, there was somebody by your side.
Yeah.
I mean,
if you were lucky to have somebody by your side, that person didn't have the good sense to wash their hands.
Absolutely. I mean, that's exactly what people were dying of all the time.
Yeah.
It's just dirty hands of, you know, germs of God knows, you know, the virus now. Interesting that it's every 100 years. I wonder why that is.
Yes.
Interesting, kind of like, why is that every 100 years? Is it some kind of lesson we're supposed to learn? I don't know.
Yeah, maybe until we learn it.
Much.
What did you say, Ken? What did you say?
I said, if it's something we're supposed to learn, we haven't learned much.
Oh my God. In fact, you know, I'm not sure if it's, we were going backwards a little, you know, in terms of learning.
Yeah, and I didn't understand why women would want to go backwards to the time when the man ruled, because it was terrible back then, and in some aspects, because a man could beat his wife, the police would come and they would tell the wife she better behave so he didn't beat her again.
That's right. And she deserved it, probably, in the policeman's eyes, you know, or anybody else's eyes.
You know, that's very interesting that you just said, because, you know, one of the things is, because politics and history do interplay, and religion, they all interplay. And one of the fascinating things to me is that one of the big steps that happened when the Muslim religion started about 800 years after Christianity was it was the first religion that gave the woman some rights.
Oh, isn't that interesting?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, that, and it wasn't okay for you. You know, you couldn't just beat your wife. You could only beat her with a certain size stick.
Oh, wow. You know, it's been, I mean, women are, I hate to say this, please men forgive me, but you know, women are the courageous ones. They're the ones who have the babies, and especially in the 1700s, 1800s, who, you know, died most of the time from childbirth. They were the ones who took care of their families. They were the ones who, you know, when the man was gone, you know, the family survived. So the woman.
Come on. I think you're being kind of too kind here. The real courage of women, they put up with men.
Yes.
Okay. All right. I agree. Oh, well, you know, it's, you know, we're in this crazy time now, and we all have to put up with each other.
Yeah.
You know, it's all, we all have to help each other.
It's,
I mean, I live by this quote that I'm writing a new book, and the theme of the book is, in every problem there's a gift in its hand, and we create the problem because we need the gift. So it's like, okay, what is, I keep saying to myself, what is the gift we're all, you know, the all of us trying to learn from this virus? What is the gift that I'm trying to learn from being isolated? I happen not to have any family. I'm free. I'm a free girl. I mean, I love that and always have been. But now when you reach a certain age, if you're still free and you don't have a family, you know, you're alone. So, you know, I say to myself, okay, then what that means is that I have to do some creative work, which I share with all of you out there. Even if you never thought you could write one word, I'm gonna share with you something. If you have a friend that is totally knows almost everything about you and loves you dearly, what you do is this. Your friend sits down with you with a tape recorder, I guess that's what they're called now, I mean your phone, and tape, and the friend says, asks you questions. And I'm talking about not just questions like, where were you born and what do you think about what's going on here, but I'm talking about seriously personal questions. Mm-hmm. And about, you know, how you survived this long, doing what you're doing, why you chose to do what it is in life. Then you have it transcribed. You sit down, and it doesn't have to be written nicely. It just has to be cleaned up so it's understandable. You put a leather binder around it, and you put it in your safe deposit box, and you will live forever through your family. Be able to share your story with like what we're doing, which is, you know, with friends, with to tell your story. Everybody has a story, and the story, what we have to do is that quote I said about that, in every problem there's a gift in its hand, and we create the problem because we need the gift.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. You know, find the gift in your life. What is the gift? I mean, I'm looking at the two of you. I know you guys very much from, you know, we've done stuff together like this. But we never really sat down and personally talked about ourselves.
No.
Your prize is so wonderful. You interview everybody else, but we don't know about you guys. And I know that you guys probably have fabulous backgrounds. So what I'm saying is that I believe we all are a gift to each other in terms of, especially now, this is the time to write your story. This is the time to create. I'm very supportive in telling people to be creative now, so you don't go crazy sitting in your house looking at your wall.
Let me expand on that for one second, though, because not everybody wants to write. But guess what, folks? You can paint. You can sculpt. You can get it on your computer and do it as a video. You can just get your little grandchild and tell them a story. There are so many ways to be creative.
And so one of the reasons I was excited to be with you guys, besides seeing you all again and, you know, sharing the book, is to say to out there, to the people who are listening, that, you know, you don't have to just stare at the wall or television and get angry or whatever. What you can do is actually find something creative that you've always dreamed to do, that you thought you maybe weren't good at. Like, I don't know, like you said, Ken, to sculpt, to paint, to write, to get together with a couple of friends via the computer and a little play together, you know, yes. do Zoom.
Write music. Together. I mean, there is,
that's it.
You know what I was wondering? Perhaps the gift in this is giving people time to think what really matters in their life, what their passions really are. Because most people go to work to make money. It's not that it's the job they wanted their whole life or anything. They go to work to make money.
To survive.
Yeah, just to survive. And they put all this in the background, and before you know it, they're 90 years old. You know, they didn't do what meant most of them in life. So maybe that's part of the gift that we're getting, is the time to look at that and be able to do these things.
I think that's one of the gifts. I think there's another gift that we're getting that we have to decide whether we're going to make use of or not, which is that we have a moment that things are kind of on hold. Things are stopping, and it's giving us a chance as a country, as a culture, as a society, and maybe as a world, to take stock and evaluate where we're going, what we're about. You know, we're so busy running in the rat race that maybe we forget to evaluate what's important, and now all of a sudden, maybe we have time to say to ourselves, well, do I really need all of these things, all this plastic? Do I really need to use all of this carbon-based fuel? Do I really need to have this advantage over people of a different color? What do I need and what is important to me? What will make my world a better world? And I think some of us are coming up with some pretty strong answers about that.
That's beautiful what you said. And I also think it's a time when, you know, before it's all about ourselves, our survival, our family survival. Now maybe it's the time to say, there are other people out there, other than my few friends, mm-hmm. there are people I don't know who are sad, depressed, who are not knowing what to do in life, and this has made it even worse, the virus. How can I contribute to giving something to the world that will make it, even if it's a few people, better? You guys, you know, you're doing a wonderful thing. I think you interview people that, you know, not only are interesting and creative, but, you know, maybe somebody will get something, will listen and go like, oh my God, you know, Yes, yes. I want to do whatever. That inspires me. And I think we all have to look inward now, as mm-hmm. opposed to outward, which is what most of us have. That's how we survive, to look outward, to protect ourselves and our family, and to see what the next step is, and to have enough money to survive. Now it's the time to look inward and say, how can I contribute to this, to the world, to the little world that I live in, let alone the big world? Is there anything I can do? What is it? Creative? Is it money? Is it my contribution in terms of, as a human being, just going out and being a helper of some kind, an inspirer of some kind? You guys, you know, you're inspirers. You bring people who inspire. Right. You know,
well, I was
reading something the other day about this kid. He's 11 years old, and it occurred to him that there were a lot of single moms where he lives. I believe he's in Maryland. A lot of single mothers, and he decided they needed help. So he opened a lemonade stand. He sells chips, candy, lemonade, and all the proceeds he turns it to Walmart, and he buys diapers, wipes, things like that, and donates them to single mothers. Well, needless to say, his neighbors have all gotten involved. The kids raised thousands of dollars.
Oh my God.
And it just took blood and person.
Inspiration.
Yeah, and you know, if you just think, all of the people.
What made you say, I'm sorry, Monica.
Oh, no, I was just saying it all started with one person.
Thanks. This is, you know, so maybe each one can look at a way to make the world better.
Yes, maybe, you know, everybody who's listening, you know, they're going like, oh, I don't have any talent. I don't know what to do. I don't paint. I don't write. I don't know how to do any of that. Well, what is the one, when you were a kid, you know, when you were 10, 12 years old, what is it you wanted to be when you grew up, other than a princess or a cowboy? what was there in life that have you always dreamed, if someone could wave a magic wand to help other people, how would that be? How, you know, not just money, you know, putting money in the church plate or whatever, or contributing to the Red Cross. I'm talking about in the giving as well.
And I'm seeing that happen a lot now that people are home more, just in our own neighborhood. Well, we had our house burn down and all that, but there's we're back. That's why we were off the air for a while. But Paradise, remember 2018, but anyway, there's people who are still living in RVs and they have lots that are over, you know, there's brush growing all over and it's dangerous. So there's a group of volunteers in our community who are going around and cutting all that down for them. They're not getting a penny for it.
Oh.
But they're caring enough to do this. And I'm seeing this happen a lot. And I hope
I'm
it continues.
I'm going to interrupt you, Monica, because I want to go back to something Karen said, because, you know, we want to make this a real interview, personal interview. Karen, share with the audience, what was it you wanted to do when you were a kid? What was that secret dream you had besides being a princess?
I never wanted to be a princess. Well, I was on the Art Link Letters show when I was 8 years old. And I suddenly, for some reason, because I was very chatty and I guess I was funny and peculiar, and so I was chosen. So the show, they asked me what I wanted to be when I grew up, and I said I wanted to be a movie star. Okay, fine. Everybody, that's like the princess and the cowboy. But the thing that I realized when I was young was, you know, I wanted to make my mommy and my grandma happy. First of all, it was donuts from the Ralph's Market. Would make donuts and then put them in big trays to dry. So I would climb over the fence to get donuts from my mother and grandmother. And then I learned that that wasn't a good thing. That was called stealing. But what I'm saying is that, you know, out of my life. It's such a beautiful thing for us to all think about. Forget the money. Don't contribute. I mean, yes, contribute, but that's not what we're talking about here for the listeners. We're talking about what is it that will give you pleasure, which will change you a little bit, which will make you feel really good about yourself, and that you are on this earth, even if you helped one person who said to you, looked you in the eye and was crying and said, oh, without you, you know, it's making me cry.
Well, you know, better than anything when you do something unselfishly to help. That's the best feeling.
I'm not letting you get away with that. I got to ask you the same question. When you were a little kid, besides being a cowgirl or a princess, what did you want to be? What was your dream?
My problem is I wanted to be a lot of things. And I have to tell you that I have done all of them.
Well, tell me what they were.
I didn't get paid for most of them. Some of them I did. I was actress, singer,
okay, yeah,
artist, yes, writer, or author. I play the piano, not excellently, but all the things that I loved, reading, you know, cooking, sewing. I love everything. And that's why Ken has to reel me in sometimes and get me concentrated on writing, because I go off and do all these other things.
Well, okay, so you're here now. Here's this moment in time. We're the age that we are, we're doing what we're doing. And by the way, I really love what you're doing, you know,
Thank you.
And you're both beautiful human beings. Thank you for being in our world, you know. But let me just ask both of let me be the interviewer for a moment. So what is it that you have to, because it'll help the reader, the listeners, you know, what do you have to contribute inside of you that you've always wanted to do or be? You know, what is that for both of you?
My answer, and I think people will laugh, inside of me, I've always felt like I'm that person that is directing a meeting, but it's for the good of people, if you know what I mean. It's getting people back to loving and caring each other. And I'm actually, that's in my soul, is to be a speaker, to speak out about these type of things. And I fought it my whole life because, yeah. Not so much now, though. I do speak my mind, huh, Ken?
Yeah, you do.
I wanted to start a new kind of church, honest to goodness.
What kind of church?
See, I have a problem with religion, only that I definitely believe in God, but I have a problem in everyone thinking that their God's the right one and we're going to kill you if you don't believe in him and that and this and that. I want someone to be able to come to a church where it's about love and kindness and doing good in your life. And then you go home to God.
It doesn't have to be a church.
Right.
You know, it can be, you know, just like once a week or once a month, you bring in friends of yours and you sit down and you all go like, okay, so this week, even if it's a teeny thing, what do you want to do? Well, maybe I want to go to the Red Cross and I want to, I don't know, do whatever, you know, whatever it is, or I want to write a poem or what, you know, it could be.
Yeah. I volunteered for hospice twice and it was one of the most heart-wrenching but rewarding things I've ever done. And I'm telling you, if anybody can do that, these people need a friend, even if it's just seeing them on video right now. There's people that could use your friendship.
You know what would be interesting? I was just thinking about if I had the willpower to do it, it would be to have a program like yours, and I would interview, when I say the common man, I don't mean that they're common. Nobody's common. Everybody's special.
Yes. People who just are picked at random.
But people who, you know, don't consider themselves actors or writers or interviewers or have programs. People who are, you know, run the gas stations. People who are, you know, somebody in your local little tiny market who is behind the counter who comes from India. You know, it's those to interview just the common man, and when I say common, we're all common. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's nothing more special.
I think what you're saying, Karen, yeah. and I think what Monica is saying, and what I would say if I were answering that same question, is that the three of us really believe in helping people to communicate with one another.
Yes.
That we really believe in communication, which may be why we're all sitting here on It Matters Radio talking, because we believe in communication. We believe in sharing. I think the thing that I want to add before we run out of time is the thing that makes us perhaps a little different is that it's very easy to talk about, hey, how are the Bears doing? What do you think about the, you know, what? It's very hard to go inside and share what's inside of us. Doug Hammarskjöld, who was the Secretary General of the United Nations, once said, there is no end of talking because there is no end to the tears. Tears of the heart.
Yeah.
And I think that
beautiful.
Has been my thinking a long time now. What I want to do and what I hope, and I think we all three of us are talking about, is the beauty of helping people share what's inside of their hearts.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. So we are running out of time, and so I have to do a couple things because, you know, this Monica does the tech and I do the, you know, trying to keep us in some kind of order in what we're doing. So the first thing is I want to tell people that you look for The Whip, and if you just type in The Whip on Amazon, Karen's book will come out.
It's a wonderful book.
And Karen's name is spelled Karen with a K, Kondazian, K-O-N-D-A-Z-I-A-N, and I really recommend that you look for her on, you know, especially Facebook and Instagram, because those are the places I follow her, but because you'll really learn something about women and history, as well as some other interesting things, as I mentioned earlier. Now, folks, we didn't talk a lot about the things Karen has actually been in on stage and television and movies, but I understand that, Karen, that you do have a reel that you can send us. Some clips from your acting, and we're gonna, as we do so often, folks, during the coming week, we're gonna put that up. And here comes my commercial, Monica. If you follow us on YouTube, which is of course where the show is, if you follow us on YouTube, then you get to know when these extras go up.
Yes.
And you go, oh wow, yeah, I want to see that reel. So please, you know, click follow on our YouTube links and get that information. But we will be posting that, and we're really appreciative. And of course, at the end of the show, as I think I mentioned earlier, we're going to have the trailer for The Whip.
It's very nice of you. It's interesting, this little 3-minute thing that I have, which is one is the drama and one is the comedy, which all actors have to have. But I, you know, I did all kinds of interesting shows like NYPD Blue. The only reason I bring that up is that was the show that kind of like, you know, did things that other shows didn't do in the 80s and 90s.
Yes.
Naked on that show, I played a crazy lady. And I opened the door naked. Of course, you only saw my bottom, my tush. But I'm just saying that, you know, it was like such an experience to do that. And so we all have like little secrets in our closet. That was kind of an interesting experience I had. And so you'll see there's part, a little clip, you might see a little bit of that. If you're anyway, I'm teasing, but I just want to say to you guys, I'm really, really happy to be here. I wish we could be doing this for a long time and I could interview you guys if you ever want me to interview you. But, you know, I want to finally say we should have people who are, as I said, they call us the common people, the people who are, you know, not the movie stars, not the president, things like that. And, you know, to interview those people, that's interesting to me.
We actually do periodically on Facebook, Karen, we actually do ask people who have posted opinions of things and say, hey, do you want to come on? And unfortunately, we don't get many people.
Most are afraid.
We're scared. Are you kidding? It's hard enough for us to do this. I mean, you guys are doing it for a while. You're used to it. But even for me, and I'm an actor, you know,
One of the things we tell them is, hey, look, we're not going to put it up if you don't like it. So, you know, we'll do the interview, then you can, if you don't want it, if you don't like it after you watch it, we won't put it up. We're not going to force it on you.
That's so beautiful. I mean, I'm saying how much I respect you guys. It's lovely to be here. We could talk all afternoon. You have to tell me when we're going to stop, by the way, because I feel like, you know.
Actually, we're right at that time now.
You have to stop. But so Gail, I would love it at some point if you'll come back and maybe we can talk more about, say, theater, which is another subject we love.
I would love that. I mean, you know, I did a play with called Sweet Bird of Youth with a young actor who his first role in Hollywood, and that was Ed Harris, you know?
Yeah.
And, you know, I've done some interesting plays with interesting people to talk about.
You played Mia Callas in Masterclass?
Yeah. Oh my God, yes, I did.
One of my favorite plays.
But anyway, you just tell me, I feel like I'm chattering away here, but.
We're about ready now to say goodbye, but I want everyone to hold on because I want you to take a look at this trailer. It's just going to really catch your interest and get the book. They even have it in audio.
Oh, yes.
And thank you so much, Karen, for joining us again. Please keep in touch. And like Ken said, come on back with us sometime and we'll talk on another topic, okay?
I love you both. I send you both a hug. And, I love that you're putting the trailer up. Thank you.
Okay.
Thanks a lot.
Thanks a lot, Karen. Okay, folks, here you go. Bye-bye.
Hi, this is Bob Dion from Dion Audio. We're in the process of directing The Whip, Karen Kondazian's book, and in studio is Robin Weigert.
Gonna feel like a baby rocking in its cradle. The Concord Company is sending over three more just like her. Sacramento is now the busiest stage hub in the country. We need the best because we are the best. We've got the best horses, the best runs, and by far the best whips. I'm proud of you boys. You are nickel-plated and don't you forget it. That's why I chose you, and that's why you work for us. Now, to cap the climax, I have some important news. In a few months, our company will be merging with Wells Fargo and Company.
Great job. Very good. Very good.
Well, there's a natural link between Charlie Parkhurst and Calamity Jane, and I think it makes sense that this would possibly fall into my hands. Calamity Jane didn't disguise herself as a man, but she almost did. And did men's work and drove teams of cattle and so forth. So I've spent some time investing in what that might feel like. I feel a certain kinship with the character.
I discovered her reading an article in Cosmopolitan magazine when I was in my 20s, and there was an article about the Wild Women of the West. I sort of became addicted to thinking about her, like, what an interesting journey she took. I was wanting to be an actress at that time, and so I would put myself in her place thinking, how would I cover myself? How would I, you know, 24 hours a day, how would I, all these guys, you know, they peed together. How would she pee? How would she get away with having her period? How would she cover her body? How would she sound, look, you know, all these things. So I started writing, and there's this thing about me where once I start something, I have to finish it. And so it took me 6 years.
I spent some time with the book and tried different voices out for different characters, and it's still a work in progress as we're working on it, because it's finding, you hear a little click when a character has the right sound suddenly. There's a distinct moment in time when she goes undercover as a man. And so she too can be trying on a voice, a little tentatively at first, that she later learns to own. I would compare it more to being a director, because you have to have some kind of an overview of how everybody is relating to everybody else, and stay with them all inside the scene and paint the scene. So you're also sort of building sets and you're creating an environment and you're endowing each of these people with their very specific kind of inner life. And if it's a conversation between two young kids who, you know, in the course of the whole story are going to be aging into people whose journeys take them very far afield from where they began, you also have to be aware that you're planting a tiny seed, even when you're portraying them as children, that will grow into what they'll become later.
Let's pick that up again, if we could.
The Concorde is the best. It's as smooth a ride as you're ever going to get. You're going to feel like a baby rocking in its cradle. The Concorde Company is sending over three more just like her.
It is a book of survival, and not just survival, but I believe that in every problem there's a gift in its hand, and we create the problem because we need the gift. And I think I know that's what Charlie did. She made a gift of her life.
I think we all figure out who we are a bit by looking in the mirror, and then decide how to live into who we've become. And Charlie has a very specific moment like that, where she says, I cannot be this shattered woman who I once was, who I was yesterday, in fact, who had everything taken from her. And I'm going to instead step into the shoes of a man. And this man is going to carry me through the rest of my life with greater strength and greater ease than I could ever have mustered as a woman. So, it allows me as a reader of the part to just go, and now it's different.
The question that runs through it is, if someone destroyed horribly everything that you love in this world and everybody, could you forgive them? And if you couldn't, how far would you go?
She gave herself rights and entitlements that no one else would have given her. And in that way, it's a very modern story, in a way, of a woman deciding to own herself. Jim Birch, president of the stage company, stood with some of his top drivers, Hank Monk and Charlie among them. At Charlie's side was an excited Tonya. Here she is, said Birch, tidy and graceful as a lady, and, like a lady, barely a straight line on her body. I think Karen has done such a beautiful job imagining, because, you know, a lot of this has to be filled in. There's some history there, but there's a lot of it that's left up to the imagination. What it might truly have been like to live such a life. I'm finding it a very creative process, because you're both exploring and inventing at the same time. You're trying to perform some kind of excavation. What's there? And you're also seeing what you can bring to it that will bring forth what is there. And I've never done an audiobook before. So all of it's very challenging and very engaging and very fun for me.
I have the great Robin birthing it. I'm very lucky, and very lucky to have Bob Dean also producing it. You can get hold of me by my website, which is Karen-Kondazian. thewhipnovel.com or the book's website, which is thewhipnovel.com.
That was great. Fantastic. Let's wrap it. Good job. All right.